But on the inflammation side, I've been thinking a lot about this recently, because number one, and this is not that uncommon, but I've noticed, for instance, if I'm consuming carbohydrates, cycling carbohydrates, and I'll do, say, a cheat day like yesterday, mm-hmm. where I'm eating like, you know, an entire pound cake by myself, you know, this kind of thing. And then I get, even several hours later, get acupuncture. And that's a whole separate conversation. But I will bleed more. So, like, I will bleed much more than if I am, say, in a ketotic state. Mm-hmm. But then I have all these questions that come to mind. For instance, like, I mean, I'm consuming like turmeric with like ground pepper or right. like, because I always read it. I never say it. Piperine.
Yeah, piperine.
There we go. So to increase the bioavailability and absorption.
Right.
So that's pretty old school, right? You've got like turmeric, curcumin pills or whatever. I mean, there mm-hmm. are a million ways to go about it. But I've tried to whenever possible. So you have like L-methylfolate, let's say. Very interesting to me, but unless I'm mistaken, like pretty new kid on the block. It's relatively relatively new addition to the kind of supplement arsenal. Whereas like turmeric tea, it's like, okay, Ayurvedic medicine, they've been doing that for thousands of years. Like right. I'm like, I feel pretty comfortable like bringing in turmeric tea with like some ginger and black pepper to counteract unnecessary inflammation.
Yes.
Right. At the same time, I'm like, but inflammation, this is where maybe you can help me gain some clarity. I'm like, but inflammation also serves some really important purposes,
yes.
right? So if, for instance, you have people go do a weight training workout, and there's a fair amount of empirical data, I don't know if there's research data to support this, where athletes will be like, oh my God, I don't want to be so sore after my workout. I'll take NSAIDs, right? And I'll take like Advil, ibuprofen, whatever, to facilitate recovery. Mm-hmm. And in fact, then they have less hypertrophy mm-hmm. and they have less muscle growth right. as a result. So it's like, what is the inflammation that we want to not interfere with versus the inflammation that we should try to prevent?
Yes, I think that it's something I've been thinking about in a similar way with inflammation and also antioxidants, because I think that the type that you want to interfere with is the chronic inflammation, the kind that's coming from your gut, that's leaking endotoxin, which is released from like dead bacteria when they get, you know, and it causes all sorts of damage because it binds to cholesterol. And anyways, I can get into this whole conversation, but it's the bad stuff. And, you know, the inflammation that's causing that chronic reactive oxygen species, which damages DNA, proteins, lipids in your cells, which gets into the brain and stops serotonin from being released. So it causes depression, things like that. So
sounds like a bad cycle.
Yes. Very vicious cycle too, because then you start to activate more inflammatory right. molecules. I think the good type of inflammation, the good type of damage, the good type of stress is when you exercise.
Yeah.
It is when you're doing that type of exercise or heat stress or cold stress
yeah.
or that type of transient, you know, stress on the body that induces all these, you know, the expression of genes that deal with stress. So, it, you know, you're increasing the expression of all these good genes that deal with inflammation and express. And having that inflammation, having that stress is critical to do that. I mean, that's how turmeric works and mm-hmm. curcumin. Yeah. The one of the ways it works is it's actually slightly toxic to us.
Mm-hmm.
And because it's slightly toxic to us, our body goes, oh, wait a minute, I need to increase the expression of all these genes so that they make more of the gene to yep. do all this good stuff, to fight inflammation, to fight, you know, reactive oxygen species, all that bad stuff. So I think it's sort of like
it's like what Dread Pirate Roberts did in The Princess Bride with Iocane powder.
Yes.
A little bit every day.
Yes. But I mean, it's like the chronic versus acute good type of stress,
right?
So I think that's something, you know, that's what I think about. And I also have been thinking about it in regards to like supplemental antioxidants
mm-hmm.
because, you know, I used to take a lot of vitamin C,
mm-hmm.
supplemental vitamin C. And then, and you know, there were studies that were showing, you know, taking 2 grams of supplemental vitamin C a day with lowered C-reactive protein. And, you know, there's all these reasons why I was taking it. But then studies started to come out where, you know, if you take the supplemental vitamin C, like after a workout, you know, the half-life is like an hour and a half in
yeah,
plasma
sure.
or something. Yeah. But then all the, you know, when you work out, you create oxidative stress and that
yeah.
you want that. That's what induces mitochondrial biogenesis. Like
yeah.
that stress is what signals to the mitochondria to make more mitochondria. But if you dampen that by like sequestering that stress with
yeah.
an antioxidant, then you're not going to get those benefits.
Mm.
So now, and there's studies now showing this both in humans and also in mouse animals. So now I'm kind of a little more cautious about
yeah.
supplemental antioxidants specifically because they can sequester some of that good stress that you want from things like, you know, exercise or intermittent fasting, for example, things like that. So I think it's
interesting. So you think antioxidants could negate some of the benefits of, say, intermittent fasting?
Yes, they can. And it's been shown that they can. And, you
know, that's good to know.
It's supplemental antioxidants, because when you're intermittent fasting, there are a lot of things are going on, but it is a type of stress. Mm-hmm. And when you're stressing your cells, you know, things are, you're creating reactive oxygen species. That's what happens. And part of that, there's a hormetic effect. So when you create these reactive oxygen species, and this is the good type of stress, like creating reactive oxygen species because you're chronically inflamed, because you're eating processed carbohydrates and you're poking holes in your gut and leading to inflammation and blah, blah, blah. That's not the good type. You don't want that constant reactive oxygen species being made every day. But when you're intermittent fasting or when you're exercising, that burst of it, which is much more powerful. So it's not like a little bit each day. It's like, boom, here I am. It's enough to signal to your genes, to other cells, you know, make more of this gene that deals with inflammation, make more of this gene that deals with stress, make more mitochondria. It's just enough to do that. That's some of the benefits of intermittent fasting and exercise, or rely on that.